Note that I've only seen this movie once, so it's possible I may have missed or forgotten some details. The characters. The Mallard family, who are conveniently a family of Mallard ducks, consists of Mac, the stubborn father and husband, Pam, the wife of Mac, who has to endure his antics, Dax, the older brother, Dan, played by Danny DeVito of It's Always Sunny in Philadelphia fame, and Gwen, the younger sister and empathetic one. The characters, while a bit archetypal, are pretty well defined. Uncle Dan's old man antics come up frequently, yet don't impose themselves on the film as much as, say, Granny from Ice Age, so they've dialed it in pretty well, in my opinion. They occasionally move the plot forward without being mean-spirited and spiteful. The plot. Spoiler warning. I'll be going effectively chapter by chapter here. I think by describing the scenes I can comment on what I liked, though there's different amounts to say about each scene. Discussion of the plot elements will contain spoilers. If you just want to see my review of the other elements and the overall film, skip to the chapter time shown on screen. The movie opens with Pam and Mac telling Gwen and Dax a bedtime story. This introduces the characters in conflict. Pam and Mac fight for control of the narrative, with Mac's fears driving him to tell a bleak story, while Pam drags the story back to an optimistic one. The story is about herons. While the movie isn't about herons, the way they talk to each other and about the world is revealing. The discussion of herons is not entirely a throwaway introduction, as will be shown later, yet the story indulges the audience with an actual encounter, yet also quickly grows beyond it. Call to adventure. A new flock of ducks happen to land on their pond while migrating. Gwen teasingly tries to pair Dax and one of the ducks, while Pam and Mac frantically search for them. This introduces migration to the characters who so far prided themselves on never leaving home. While the conflict builds, the migrating ducks leave and the family misses on their chance to follow them. Answering the call. Uncle Dan is introduced later, at night, when he emerges from the mud and reveals he overheard everything. Dan and Mac seem to be on the same page at first about philosophy, but Dan's age allows him to see where that leads, by experience. While he's embraced it, revealing that conclusion scares Mac. It turns out that Mac wanted to be safe, not alone, and isn't holding on to the ideals just for the sake of it, so it becomes a turning point where he becomes a driving force to bring the family on the migration. At first no one believes he's really changed, but eventually he convinces them he is for real. Witch's Hut. Shortly into their flight, a storm grounds them. There they encounter the herons, who take them into a sort of witch's hut. The heron plot twist was almost pretty good. Someone who seems strange at first and has a number of suspicious circumstances, yet was really only trying to save them from another threat. It does leave the reasons why a bit unclear, though. Not over-explaining it is good for simplicity, but you're left never knowing quite what the writers intended with that. The herons don't show up again after their scene, however. I don't think there's any kind of message about people who seem strange might actually be alright or anything. It's left fully ambiguous and strange, but ultimately the ducks do get to leave and continue their journey where they left off. The joys of flight. The Mallard family takes flight and soars to new heights. They have a snowball fight using the clouds. New York. The family shrugs off noticing every other migrating bird heading the opposite direction and accidentally fly to New York City. There they meet Chump, a pigeon played by Awkwafina. When they first arrive at the city, they're unprepared for urban travel and have to adapt quickly. They nearly crash into buildings and have to dodge cars as they hurtle around the unfamiliar territory. When they eventually land and regroup, they meet Chump when Uncle Dan snags a discarded sandwich from the ground, which attracted pigeons. The Mallards get into a bit of a turf war, but then it's revealed that Chump essentially just wants to be respected and that pigeons are looked down on compared to ducks. They become friends and Chump leads them to a contact that can help them get where they're going. I think Awkwafina did a good job in this role. Ratatouille Rio Heist. Chump leads them to a restaurant where they meet a Jamaican macaw named Delroy, who's played by Keegan-Michael Key, also known for playing Toad in Super Mario Bros. There are no drug references that I can remember in this film. Delroy misses his home and fears the chef, who conveniently holds the key to his cage. The chef is a brutal man who rules his kitchen through fear and is prone to throwing things in anger. Mac goes out to fetch the key. Wacky hijinks ensue when a few heist tropes occur. Someone unexpectedly tagging along and a fumble causing them to be detected. They free Delroy, who begins to lead them to Jamaica, and the chef becomes a recurring villain. Chump doesn't go with them, which is fine. Along the way, they take a rest stop, and Gwen is frightened by an eye symbol on or near a door. Everyone goes through the door into a basement, and they look around before they hear a humming. They follow the sound to another door where it's revealed to be a barn full of ducks practicing yoga. The leader, Gugu, is happy to invite them to participate. Gugu introduces them to Paradise, a water park and spa made for ducks. Now, it could just be me being slightly trope-savvy. I'm not an expert or anything, but it gives me sinister vibes, which turns out to be somewhat true. The entire facility turns out to be unsubtly selling out the entire flock to the chef. For what it's worth, I don't think Gugu knew about this. He seems well-meaning yet naive, and he would have been taken with them. He wasn't maliciously guiding Phlox to their demise, but the farmers he trusted so much were. This is where they inject a bit of family drama, too. Mac tries to insert control, which leads to Dax trying to save Dax himself. The chef breaks Dax's feathers, rendering him unable to fly, but they all manage to escape, including Yoga Farm Dax. Poolside seething. Everyone rests at a pool. They're exhausted and, whether they know it or not, on the run from the chef. Gwen is worried because Dax is unhappy, but things take a turn for the worse when the chef arrives in the helicopter the Mallards encountered earlier at the restaurant. The chef catches everyone except Gwen and Dax in a net, including the dozens of farm ducks. Gwen understandably cries, and when she wipes her face with one of the distinctive long red feathers of Delroy, Dax is inspired. Climactic battle. While most of the birds are locked in a cage in the back of the helicopter, Mac and Pam are kept together in a smaller cage at the front, with the chef. Mac accidentally realizes he can lift the cage by standing up, revealing their feet can go through the bottom bars of the cage. It takes several tries before Delroy suggests a synchronization dance. This is a bit of a healing moment for Pam and Mac. The dance explodes into a launch towards the button, but right as they're about to reach it, they're caught and pulled back by the chef. A food fight ensues as vegetables are hurled at the chef from the prison cell, and during the fight, the control for the bottom doors falls and activates. The chef is tangled in the net and hauled away by the helicopter. Pam and Mac fall in a terrifying moment in one of those falling while restrained scenes. When all seems hopeless, Dax and Gwen swoop in. Dax is revealed to have repaired his wing feathers using Delroy's feathers to replace the damaged ones. There's a tense moment as Gwen and Dax work to pry open the cage, and they escape before the cage crashes into the ground or ocean. Missed opportunity. Missed opportunity to have a dilemma of going back to save everyone else from the helicopter. They ended up freeing themselves after the tense moment with the repaired wing reveal. But I guess since they had already solved rescuing the guide before, they didn't want to do it twice. The purpose of that had already been achieved, and the characters are moving forward in their journey, not just physically traveling but developing as characters. And the aforementioned climactic moment means, for the sake of preventing fatigue and not overshadowing it, they gave the characters a freebie there. Finding Jamaica. After a night of flying, they fear they have gotten lost. However, the glowing water they were told about previously comes into play. Then the sun rises and reveals they did, in fact, make it to Jamaica. Conveniently, they run into the family of ducks that invited them to join the migration all the way back at the beginning of the movie. Dance Party. The main plot ends with a dance party set to Cloudy Day by Tones and I. Like Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 3's dance party music, in my opinion, it doesn't match the tone and energy of the film, and can be a bit jarring, but it's serviceable and tangentially related to the film. Epilogue. There's a scene at the end that seems like it's meant to set up a sequel, but the story is actually then told through a series of Polaroid pictures during the end credits. The film. Illumination. Illumination has come away from being considered a joke or budget studio to something of a maturity. Being inundated with Minions marketing can be annoying, but I think it's just noticeable because they have only a few characters compared to other studios, and of those characters, only a few of them have been a hit. Dabbling in original films again marks a good change in a time when the animation giants are following deeper into self-derivative works. Now, Illumination is planning to make another Despicable Me movie, so I'm not saying you're an absolute hero in that film, but I don't fault them either. It's not for me, but they're keeping a good thing going. I just hope that the box office performance of Migration and the poor reception of their other originals like Sing don't discourage them from making a few more original films. The movie is prefaced by a short called Mooned, which in my opinion goes on for too long. It kind of feels like they think you won't be invested in the movie if they don't cram Minions in there somewhere. It's DVD extra material, but not in a good way. If it were maybe a minute or two, I could see it being just a way of going, hey, where are the Minions guys? It doesn't set up the film or lead into it in any way. You don't have to be familiar with the Minions franchise in order to enjoy the movie, but the premise of the short seems to be to fill a gap in the timeline of the Minions franchise. So if you watch the Despicable Me movies but not Migration, hopefully you're not missing out on much. Yet it doesn't add anything to the movie it's attached to. It's also not just a random creative effort like Pixar shorts. It would be like if every Disney movie started with 10 minutes of Mickey Mouse or something like an episode of Zootopia Plus. It might still be funny out of context, but if you haven't watched or care for the series, then it's an extra that's too entangled with the material that it's referencing to stand alone, yet completely separate from what you're watching at the moment. Maybe the target audience really was intended to be just 100% only diehard Minions fans that have watched all the related films, despite not being connected in any other way that I know of. The appeal is slightly more broad than that, so it can be a disservice. I know it's not super serious, I doubt anyone's going to walk out of the theater over it. Simplicity. I think this film brings back some simplicity in animation while also trying a few interesting things. Shot composition. Every shot, or nearly every shot, looked like it was meant to be in a trailer. I'm not sure if that's a good thing or a bad thing. Surely they didn't make an entire movie like that out of uncertainty of which shots would be used for the trailer, so maybe it's just a stylistic thing? Lighting and color. Lighting and color look good. There's a lot of visual clarity in each scene. I think they've managed to strike a balance where it's excessively polished, yet somehow still storybook-like and not overly sterile. The theater I watched it in did have some brightness issues, so it might look even better on a quality display. Between this and the Super Mario Bros. Movie, I think illumination has become a graphical force to be reckoned with. Foreshadowing. I appreciate the use of foreshadowing throughout the film. It may be considered basic, but it's satisfying when something comes up later and ties things together, especially on such a sprawling adventure where the settings are flying by. The chef just happening to visit the farm the ducks nearly missed on the same day they arrived there is a bit of a stretch, but it's okay. Overall, I'm learning to be careful about overstating the excellence of a film before having time to think about it. I don't dislike it, however low of a bar that may be. It readily clears the floor, but to be honest, I'm not sure it soars to great heights, pun intended. It's also not a film meant for me, probably, but I wanted to see what animation was like in late 2023, early 2024, and decided to give it a chance. Maybe I'd call it delightfully mediocre, which is the second best or maybe the best kind of movie, really. I'm a simple polecat. I'd rather root for the good guys and laugh at the funny moments than slog through a movie that tries to be deep. I guess what I want is a niche where it gives you something to think about, but isn't lazy on the details. Initially, I described the movie as good, but not that good, but while writing out the plot description, I realized I do like what they did with it. Now, I don't think I would be comfortable liking it as much as some other films, but it's alright, maybe it'll grow on me. I think it would be a nice addition to a collection of films I could pull on any time and enjoy, which is a bit of an honor despite how negative I might sound about it.